So my hair is wet, but I figure I'll put the cat in to distract you guys, and welcome to the start of the Ship of Magic spoiler vlog, because apparently I have emotions and I need to talk to people about it. I've already Voxered so many people and put so many thoughts in Discord, and I still have emotions. So this is it. It's a spoiler vlog. There'll probably be a spoiler-free review somewhere, and if there is, it's in the cards. But here we go. So I've read the Farseer trilogy. I won't do spoilers for that trilogy in case you're starting with the Live Ship Traders trilogy. But I knew going into this book that I would be hurt. I knew that she would hurt me. I didn't know she would do it in 150 pages, and I'm so emotional and frustrated and angry. But in the, like, I read books to feel things, so this is actually kind of great kind of way. So when you start this story, it's kind of a choice how she chooses to start it, with the prologue with the sea serpents. And then we basically are introduced to two characters that are probably my least favorite point of views right now: Kenneth the pirate and Winthrop the priesty boy thing. Sorry, had to take a quick break. Roommate wanted to cook things, so the kitchen's over there. So if you hear something, I'm sorry. But we start off with some of my, like, characters. I don't know if I have feelings about them, but then we meet, is her name Altria, Althea? I don't know. She's awesome. She's like this 19-year-old, she's on this live ship, ships can come to life, that's really cool. And you know instantly that she will not be allowed to keep this ship. You just know. Her father's dying, when he dies, the ship's supposed to come to life, she's supposed to own it, that's not going to happen. Her dick of a brother-in-law is the captain of this ship right now. He's a complete a-hole. I hate him so much. Oh, and then we just, her father dies, and then in the moment of his death, she finds out that she isn't in the will, and that it's her older sister who then gives the ownership to her husband, who's such an a-hole. And I'm so angry. And, like, that's not even this, like, there's so many sad things here. Like, this area of traders is, like, slowly, like, devolving into capitalism, and this family is struggling. Like, there's just so much heartache. And I don't even know how I'm gonna make it. Like, I already feel more sad than I ever did in Farseer, probably because the injustice of what Robin Hobb highlights in her books is just so much more real in this one. Like, the misogyny, how capitalism basically can tear apart a community because of need, like how war can affect trade. It's just so much. So I'm gonna go back to read it because I'm actually having a great time, but, like, all the emotions. It's morning, and I'm here to say that I hate Kyle. A lot. He's the worst. He's so abusive and manipulative and controlling and he just, like, encapsulates everything I hate about the worst in humans, and I just cannot stand him. He's just knocked his son out on the floor, who doesn't even want a ship, claims that Alethea is horrible on a ship when his son is obviously going to be worse by the nature of not knowing things. But honestly, Alethea and Kyle on a ship, one of them is just going to die. This is just bad. I hate that Kyle is in this family. He's horrible. He's not great. I would prefer the pirate. Honestly, the pirate seems more reasonable. I mean, he's also, like, controlling and manipulative, but at least he doesn't get under my skin as much as of right now. All right, it's actually been a minute since I've checked in, but I am 60% of the way through, and Kyle still sucks. Malta is a trip, and there's just a lot. So I think the first 150 pages were rough. They were rough for me. I knew that it was, like, going to be this setup for just, like, sad situations for everyone, and then we would go and see how we could overcome obstacles from there. I didn't, like, know it from a review, but, like, you just feel that at the beginning, right? Like, the beginning is setting up our lowest point, or one of the low points in the story, right? And so it's been more comfortable now that we've kept going, now that there's significantly less Kyle, although every time he shows up, I just want to punch him. I think Robin Hobb is the best at making me hate characters. I have never hated characters as much as Robin Hobb has made me hate characters. I don't remember, there's a character in the Farseer trilogy, I hate him too. So, but let's see, what's happened? So I'll talk about Malta because I kind of brought her up. I think she's interesting because she's obviously a brat. Like, she's 12 years old and being like, I want to go to the ball. And, you know, her grandfather just died and everyone's like, we're not going. And on top of that, she wants to go dressed as like a woman and she's 12. But she's got some ingenuity. Her dad is such a hypocrite and basically helps her fund the endeavor, even though like Kiefra was like, you don't understand what it is to become a woman in Bingtown. Stop it. Kyle, just, if he was at least competent, I would be happier with the situation with Kyle, but he's not. He's just so dumb and controlling and hypocritical. But I find Malta interesting because she's honestly not that dissimilar to Alethea. Like, we have these two rich girls who don't want to conform to the traditions of being women in Bingtown. And honestly, our story is poor rich people. Because honestly, most of our main characters, although the house is in debt and everything, are rich people who don't get what they want. Winthrow doesn't get to become a priest, Alethea does not become captain of the ship, and I guess Malta doesn't get to go to the ball. But I find it really interesting because we are made to be sympathetic towards Alethea. I mean, like, I was legit having emotions about when she had her ship taken away. But Malta, we just think of as this brat. But honestly, their arguments are extremely similar. Their thought processes are not that different, even though I'm pretty sure their age difference is 5 to 7 years or something. And so I could see myself being convinced to like Malta one day. I mean, right now she's a 12-year-old brat and definitely her father's daughter. Oh boy. And let's see what else has happened. Oh, Winthrow's coming into his own. I'm liking him more. I don't think I've talked about him. I don't think I've talked about much other than how much I hate Kyle, because God, he represents everything I hate in people. But Winthrow has been trying to come into his own as a ship's boy and, you know, kind of figure out who he is now. He has this very strained relationship with the live ship, and because of work, he has to lose his finger. And he tells his dad, I want you to amputate this finger, and his dad is such a coward. And like, Winthrow just like, in his face is like, I'm not a Haven, I think it's a Viserit or something like that. And I'm just like, you go boy. So yeah, everything's really interesting. I like that Brashen and Alethea's plot arcs are together because I low-key ship them. Heh, ship. That's a bad joke. But I low-key want them to like date. And even if they don't, I just like both of their perspectives on that ship. I think it's really interesting. I don't know what's going to happen. I was really nervous for a minute that they were going to be, I think it's called crimped or something like that, basically stolen onto a different ship and they were going to be somewhere else. And I was just like, no, no. But this is what Hob does, guys. She makes you feel secure. I feel secure in the story right now, and I feel like my characters are growing and getting things, maybe achieving goals, and that's all gonna be taken away from me. I'm positive, because that's what happened in the Farseer trilogy. Every time I felt like this, every time I was comfortable, she just pulls the rug out from under me, so I don't know. I also feel bad for Ronica, because Ronica's the matronly woman. She's finally realized that Kyle is an a-hole and the worst. And she's like, oh darn, I made a mistake. And yes, you did. Alethea cares way more about the family, at least the health of the family, mentally and otherwise, than Kyle does. Oh boy, do I hate Kyle. I also really like Paragon. That's the live ship that went mad, which the sequel book is Mad Ship. So I'm wondering if Paragon's finally going to get to go out to sea in this series eventually. That'd be really cool. I want to know more about him. He has like some severe PTSD, like a lot of repressed memories are going on with him. And I feel like there's a bunch of lore around how he killed everyone, but I don't think any of that's true. I feel like there's some real dark history there, and I want it. I also want to know more about the Rainswild people. Basically, this area is so creepy cool. So you have these islands that people were paid to go settle because it was like bad land, essentially, or not ideal. And people used to live, I think, near this forest area, but it was just too creepy, too weird. So most people went down to where Bingtown now is and settled there. And that's where the trader families are that we start with, the one with Alethea's family and everything. And apparently, just there, the land is so weird that you don't always give birth to babies. Sometimes it's like a creature. And then the people who still live in the Rainswild and stuff like that, they have really very weird physical mutations, deformities, the way that they're described, it definitely reminds me of things like, I don't, not even radiation poisoning or anything like that, but the environment is definitely changing the body. And right now we're at a point where there's a debt owed, and if they can't pay it come winter, which is the season we're just starting, one of the blood has to go. Will it be Malta? Will it be Alethea? I don't know. I don't know which one would be more interesting. I think Malta would be really interesting because that would provide her a point in which to grow into something. And why would I be given a Malta point of view if not for something like that? But I have no clue. I'm really liking this book. When I first started it, I was engaged, but I was hurting a little bit too much to call it enjoyment. And now I'm just enjoying it. I'm really liking when I'm on one of the ships. I really like when I'm watching the women back home finagle. But, you know, but there's still also lots of moments I'm really scared. I thought Mild was gonna die. I was really nervous when that bear fight happened. Like, I was so nervous. So, yeah, I'm really liking this really stressful read. But, yeah, and also, like, the chapters can be so long. And I feel like I said this with The Mask of Mirrors that I read earlier this month. But most of the time, even though it's long, I have no issue wanting to finish that chapter. Most of the time, I want to finish the chapter if I have time to do so. So yeah, we'll see. I have 40% left. Let's see what happens. Okay, quick update. I'm at work, so the sound of machines are everywhere. Alethea is not going to get that ticket. And I'm bummed for her. Not shocked, not surprised, and now I'm real nervous for Brashen, who's like head over heels in love with her, and I ship it, I want it. But I don't think Alethea's in the right headspace for this right now. I don't see this going well. I feel like he's gonna be stood up. I think she's gonna be too prideful to like spend the night with him and be too nervous about that situation and the commitment it involves, and then she's gonna get in trouble somehow. So many people are in such precarious positions. Like Winthrow, the last time I just read about him, he just got knocked over the head, and if he wakes up in chains, won't be surprised. I don't think he'll become a slave, but he's gonna definitely end up in jail, and I don't know what's gonna happen. I was just getting comfortable with everyone's discomfort, and now we're just getting into a new phase. But that's what happens with Robin Hobb, is she lulls you into comfort, false sense of security. You feel like you know what's happening, and then another bad thing happens, because you can't have nice things when you're her characters. You just can't. I really want to know who hurt Robin Hobb. I want to know. Malta is a trip, guys. Like, I know some people don't like her, but she's a trip. I think I just like that there's this character that I can just watch, that her consequences that happen to her are her own fault. Everyone else just has really bad luck, or like just the world is cruel. Her, she's just not accepting that actions have consequences, and I'm so excited to see her actions have consequences. Plus, I think the Rainwild traitors, I want her in that world so I can see into that world. Like, that's what I want. So yes, she's a brat, she's manipulative, she's definitely Kyle's daughter, but I kind of don't mind watching her parts, because I'm just like, huh, your fault, you messed up, she just opened a dream box. That was something. Goodness, she's crazy. I think she's technically 13, so I don't know. Oh, she's just a trip. And I think the next section I get back to Winthrow, so I need to figure out what happened to him. And oh, as I predicted, Alethea stood Brashen up, hurt his feelings, he hurt her feelings, so there we are with that. All right, so I finished this chonker last night. I actually read like 225 pages of it yesterday. I'm astounded. That's just how invested I was in the end of this story. Man, there's so much that happened, so much that I need to like compile my thoughts for like a review, but for just like my, I just finished it like 12 hours ago thoughts, like it's very satisfying. It's both a very good book where I'm following people being put in harsh situations and having to overcome their circumstances, but also it reminded me of like The Way of Kings, where it did have a climactic ending and stuff that happened in its own right to make this like a book, but it sets up stuff for the future that I'm so, so excited for. So it's a really, really good first book in a series, but in my opinion, for what I like in first books in a series. So that's unexpected. Oh gosh, but so many cool things. I have this really interesting theory. I don't know if it's obvious or not. Like, I feel like there's lots of clues, but it hasn't been spelled out. But we've had these serpents the whole book. And we have the live ships. And we know the live ships are built with this magic wood. But we don't really know where it comes from, other than it has to do with the Rainwilds traders, who are cool. And I'm very excited for Malta to have to go deal with them. But I am really, really thinking that when these serpents in their past life died, because that's something that was being talked about by like the head serpent thing in the tangle, maybe their fossils are what the live ships are built out of. It could also be wood, but like I'm just thinking like petrified of these bodies or skeletons could have led it to be like that. That'd be really cool, I think. And that would also explain why Vivacia kind of has this connection with the serpents at the end. And I wonder, is she who remembers, or is it just like a live ship specifically? And that could be Paragon, although they keep saying she, and Paragon seems to identify as male. So I'm not positive, but that's like a really cool like underlying arc. Like in Farseer, there was a different underlying arc that I really enjoy. And just like the characters and where they've all ended up. I'm really nervous for Brashen because he obviously has like a drug problem, which for me always like just makes me nervous with family history and everything like that. I'm just like, oh, Brashen, this is not a good habit to form. I really, really liked the ending of it. I loved that our climax was Winthrow and Vivacia forming that bond, working together to beat the storm, and then the happy ending is being boarded by pirates. But honestly, Vivacia has a much better job now. Like, being a slaver, I think, is way worse than being a pirate ship. Personally, like, ethically. Like, they're both bad, but I'm very much in the eat the rich mode. Like, eat the rich, take their money, it's whatever. Like, obviously the economy here is not great for the common man. So, it's gonna be really interesting to see how this all plays out. And I'm gonna be curious about the stuff that is supposed to bleed in small ways from Farseer. Like, we've already had the duchies mentioned and how they are different, how they're barbaric. Which is interesting, because I found them quite refined. I mean, I find them all in a historical way, like, far removed from what I can relate to, although it still has the patriarch and, Also, Winthrow is a much better son than I would ever be. Like, I would not have fought as hard for my father to not be killed by the slaves or the pirates, I guess. I don't think I would kill him, but I wouldn't be, I don't know, standing up for him. Oh, and Kenneth! I'm really curious about Kenneth and Vivacia and how that's all gonna play out. I don't really know what I expect for Alethea. Like, she's heading back to Bingtown and there's a whole bunch of stuff messed up there, and obviously, like, who knows when Vivacia's getting back into port. Is she the mad ship? I always thought Paragon would be the mad ship in the next book, and I don't know what's happening with him and Amanda. I think that's her name. But I had a great time. I was not expecting to, and it's really, I don't have any complaints other than it made me feel a lot of negative emotions, but that was obviously the point. So I don't know. It's like for sure a pretty highly rated book for me. And I think the rest of the series would determine if this became like an all-time favorite or not. But I am definitely more invested in this and want to read the next book a lot. Versus when I finished Assassin's Apprentice, I thought it was good, but I wasn't like in a rush to read Royal Assassin. Although I did read it like the next month. And this one I'll have to wait a few months because of all my reading plans, and it makes me sad. But yeah, so much. I still hate Kyle. Yeah. I mean, I really don't like Kyle. Gosh, like, who lets their son, who's been in slavery, then put him in slavery again, like, and then try to kill him? Like, there's an argument to be made that maybe the serpent was having an effect on him if we don't understand the magic there, but I just think he legit has these anger management problems and is just an abusive individual, and I despise him. But yeah. I'm really curious to see what happens after this. So it was a great book, and I hope you enjoyed this vlog. If you made it this far, you can put a ship in the description below so I know you're here. And otherwise, if you want to talk spoilers, just make sure to put like a spoiler tag and then type a few times so no one gets spoiled in the comment. Although this is a spoiler vlog, I just want to protect people. And don't spoil future books, please. I haven't read them yet. That'd be really mean. Otherwise, like if you liked it, subscribe if you want to, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye.